Ashok, I hope Poonanjali is allowed to share the screen.
Yes, ma'am, allowed.
And we can spotlight her. It will be easier. Or let her speak, then we can do that. Okay, ma'am, we can start. It's up, so bang on 4.
Okay, so should we start? A very good afternoon to one and all present here. Education is the passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to those who prepare for it today. With these very apt words, I welcome you to Back to School 2021 Season 2 session with Ms. Poonanjali Chandro, an alumnus for the batch of 2016. Back to School is a job shadowing initiative taken up by our school for the holistic development of our students through experiential learning. Students learn to reflect and conceptualize independently through an active interaction with their environment. As a part of this venture, we reach out to our ex-students who are now qualified and successful professionals in their chosen fields with expertise and information to share with students from their alma mater using the virtual platform. Thank you, Poonanjali, for spending some time with our students, for sharing your suggestions with them, thus inspiring them to cope with the current situation and make them aware of the challenges ahead. We are happy and proud to have you amongst us as a guest speaker for this session. Being your class teacher in classes 9 and 10, it gives me great contentment to be a part of this session with you. I also remember with fondness your committed service to the motto, Service Above Self, of our social service wing. Now I hand over the proceedings to Ridhima for an introduction on our most esteemed guest. Thank you.
A very good afternoon to everyone present here. It is an honor, privilege to have amongst us Poonanjali Chandro, an alumnus of MBWA batch of 2016. Ms. Poonanjali Chandro completed her BSc with Geography Honours from Loreto College, Kolkata, and MSc in Water Policy and Governance from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Her area of expertise, only to name a few, includes academic writing, water and sustainability studies, and monitoring and impact evaluation. Presently, she is a junior research fellow in research project funded by Science and Engineering Research Board under ASEAN India, titled Agricultural Crop Water Productivity and Adaptations to Climate Change and Climate Variability in South and Southeast Asian Countries. She is also a research intern in the Indo-Swedish project focusing to analyze sustainability of water, energy, food, climate nexus approach in India through mapping irrigation patterns against potential climate change impacts on the Bias River Basin. She has a long list of achievements, but to mention a few, she is the recipient of silver medal in overall academic performance in Masters in Water Policy and Governance and the Dard Scholarship for the IGCS Winter and Summer School 2021. She also won the TTIS Award for Creative Writing and was an active interactor contributing with dedication to the vision of our school's social service club. We are proud to have you amongst us and eagerly waiting to learn and acquire information and practical knowledge from you. Now, I hand over the proceedings of this much valued session of job shadowing to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Ridhima. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. So shall I be sharing my screen? Please let me know if the screen is visible.
Yes, ma'am, screen is visible.
It's visible.
Okay, thank you so much. So a very good evening to everybody present here. But before I start off with the presentation, I really want to take a moment and thank all my teachers, thank Principal Ma'am as well for having me here. And as I mentioned, this moment is, you know, something I really cannot put down in words. It feels extremely overwhelming and is a very significant moment for me to be back to school. Like, this session is so aptly named. It's literally a moment for being back to school. So thank you so much. I have kind of tried to put up a couple of slides to share the experiences and the highlights that I have had in my journey stepping out from school and, you know, moving ahead to the different educational pursuits that I've had and then presently where I'm standing today in my professional life. But I really believe and appreciate, and, you know, I also appreciate the fact that each one of us have their own choices to make, have their own journeys. So whatever I would be sharing has been, you know, my choices and my, you know, my experience. But if I'm able to help anybody of you at any point of your, you know, career choices or decisions, I'll be really glad to do so. Moving ahead, the first, stepping stone has been when I passed out from Mahadevi Birla in the year 2016. And in my plus two, I had bioscience. And in the same year, I took admission in Loreto College, where I pursued my honors in BSc Geography with combination with economics and human rights as my minors. So this transition from having, you know, bioscience in class 12 and then moving with geography was a very conscious choice. So I never took up science with the, with the thought that I would want to rigidly, nurture my entire career or would rigidly want to grow within that periphery. But when I was in class 10, I did love a couple of subjects. So from there, I knew that I loved biology extremely. I also liked studying chemistry as well as geography. But I was aware also of, you know, my strengths and weaknesses. So somewhere on having that understanding, I felt that it would be really, you know, good even on my part, even on the fact that I could perform if I go with science. And that was the reason I took up that decision. But later in 2016, when I was sitting across the interview table in Loreto College, I really, you know, understood, and not for a moment in these many years I have had ever a thought that, you know, of this transition that I have made. Because when I was sitting for the interview, I still remember the kind of questions that I was asked. I even faced questions on maths at Loreto College when my admission interview was going on. So I really count on that decision that I had made of going with science in plus two. And, you know, that really helped me sail through the interview a lot. So when I started off with geography, I have always been a person who have chosen to reflect on whatever I'm doing, like be it when I was pursuing my academics or be it now that I'm doing something, you know, in the professional life. I've always chosen to stand and look at what I am doing. And these 3 years have been actually a very gradual process of realizing what are the courses, what it has to offer to me, and what is that I would want to go ahead with. So there are just a couple of these, sub-curriculum, if I may say, that had been under geography when I was pursuing it under CU. So we had social geography, climatology, hydrology, population geography, political geography, as well as geomorphology and GIS. So these courses, as in these 3 years, when I was studying, I could realize that each of these courses has had a lot to actually offer to me, offer to any person, you know, pursuing geography. There are just other, you know, greater opportunities that we can actually explore from a particular sub-course also that we are having under geography. So like GIS has been an extremely significant course, I might say. Like, it's a course that has a great value, be it standing alone or even when we are trying to, you know, study or understand its application as an interlinkage amongst other courses. So, you know, like, I had tried to kind of list up few things that I had explored when I was pursuing my geography subject, like in Loreto, and I was trying to understand that which is the best next thing that I should be doing. So right when I was in the first year of my college, Loreto College, I was aware of TISS, and that had been kind of a target university for me to achieve. So I always had that also back in my mind. And I was also trying to understand that how is geography preparing me for that larger goal? So, you know, from geography, somebody can obviously go ahead and pursue a general master's on that. And somebody can even choose to do a specialization. So for general master's, there are a whole lot of universities across India to, you know, pursue your master's post graduation. There is the JNU, then you can also pursue it under DU from your own, from our home state university as well. We can pursue master's. But there are also opportunities of, you know, pursuing things which are more specialized, like, for example, a natural resource management course or a climate studies or even the water sector studies, then population studies and and public policy. So from political geography, I have seen like many of my friends have actually chosen to go ahead and pursue public policy at universities like TISS Hyderabad, as well as Azim Premji University. These actually provide very promising curriculum and a very promising quality of education in public policy. Even for population studies, the Indian Institute of Population Studies, IIPS in Mumbai, is also like a really, you know, favored and a go-to place for many who want to, you know, pursue their studies ahead in population studies. Even to pursue any kind of studies around water sector, the Terry University in Delhi, TISS Mumbai, you know, these are universities that actually also provide great opportunities in terms of exposure and also a great learning experience for the students. Now, moving ahead in the year 2021, I post-graduated with MSc in Water Policy and Governance. So I got into TISS the same year I completed my bachelor's in Loreto. And the process to get into TISS has been, you know, the TISNET examination. It's a national level examination they have. Then there had been a couple of rounds of GD, other written examinations, and finally the personal interview. So when I took up Water Policy and Governance, my major objectives were two. First is the water sector has actually evolved to be a very crucial sector, even when it comes to the point of discussion. So we must be very much aware of the recent COP26 that ended. And even in that COP26, when people were discussing about climate change, you know, climate change as a sector or as the impacts that it is creating has very close interlinkages with that of water. Even if you're talking about the larger discourse of sustainability, resource management, water just somewhere plays a very crucial role, somewhere forming the core of the conversations, actually. And that has been one of my motivations to pursue water policy. Secondly, when I was pursuing geography in Loreto, the course on hydrology had actually interested me a lot, had kind of pushed me and made me more curious to know about the water sector. And that is what I even meant, that when we are in college, when we are, you know, being through that entire course for 3 years, it's very important that we also reflect back on that course and not just, you know, just theoretically study it. And also, I would say that a mind for internships also helps us in able to figure out that what we would want to do or what is our stronger calling. So that had actually also contributed in my decision of taking up water policy and governance. And finally, when I was at the position of, you know, taking up my master's, I had done a good amount of research to understand that which are the universities I would want to apply in which and for which course. Like, for example, GIS, I had even applied for GIS. I had applied at BITS Mishra. So BITS Mishra is known to, you know, like the department there in BITS Mishra is known to even handle projects for the Indian government. So I remember when after I had secured a seat there as well. So when I had gone for my document verification, I still remember to have met an army officer, the Air Force officer there. So he had come there because the government of India had kind of sponsored his education there, and they just wanted him to, you know, upgrade upgrade his GIS skills. So GIS can is that much of a meaningful course in itself. So now, like for water policy, though I had applied in TISS, the department had a strength, like it chooses just 16 people from across India. And when I had gone for my personal interview level, I remember there were like more than 50 people in the line for interview on the first day, and the interview spanned across 5 days. So we can very well understand the probability and the ratio. So these are just some things that we always have to keep in mind. So I had even applied to Terry. In Terry, I had applied for climate studies and as well as for water policy. But since TISS happened, and you know, that's why I did not go ahead with my admission in Terry or BITS Mishra. But it's very important that we explore opportunities, explore options, and do keep a backup. Because I believe when we are in school, we are in an extremely comfortable position. You know, like I know most of you might be already in your class 11 and 12, but still the moment you step out of school, you will realize that how much taken care, you know, we are, and we are spoon fed, you know, to a very large extent. Like our class teachers would be knowing us. Your maths teacher will be knowing you by name, your geography teacher, history teacher, each one will know you by name. They'll know you personally. But the moment you step out of school, you move to your graduation college, then to your post-grad college, it's you just somewhere get lost in the crowd, and that's how it happens. You sometimes just are reduced to the roll number on the attendance book. So it is very important that you understand that, you know, that we understand that environment, and we also you know, start taking onus of, you know, the decisions we are making, and we also need to kind of research our options. And, you know, keep a number of options before we head on with one. So it is very important that we do a proper research before we step into anything ahead. Now, speaking about the course of water policy and governance, like the course in TIA was something that really encouraged us to have in the first year a very horizontal understanding of the entire sector, where we get a kind of a macro level understanding of each of the sector, be it the urban water, rural water sectors, or the WASH, water regulation, water conflicts, or even about, you know, the legal aspects of the water sector, the economic aspects of the water sector, or even, you know, something around the contemporary discourses is that of the water, energy, food nexus, or the impacts of climate change on water sector in its whole. So that is how the course has largely been in TISS. It is then moving ahead in the second year that one is encouraged to pick up a certain topic and dive deeper into it as much as possible. And that is where we produce our first research thesis. So that has been largely the curriculum design of the water policy and governance in TISS. What really sets this course, you know, sets this different from other courses is that besides you developing an understanding of water, so water is a sector that has to do a lot around technical aspects as well, right? But there is also a very crucial undertone of the social dynamics that impact the water sector. And this course actually pushes us into also looking at the sector through that lens. So that had been you know, a major thing that I actually came across when I was, you know, also going through this course description when I was applying for this particular course. Now, like if you look at these sectors as that of urban water sector, the rural water sector, or even WASH, or even water regulation, water conflicts. So just as I have been when I was doing this entire my geography course in my undergraduation. So I very much remember that I was a person who would, as I said, would reflect back. The same thing is what I did when I was pursuing my post-graduation course. I used to reflect back at the sector which, you know, which would be my calling and would, which I felt to, you know, contribute to. So GIS here has also played a very important role in the entire learning. And I would, you know, suggest that this is a very simple tool. Even if you go on YouTube, you will get a couple of, you know, videos. So if you're really interested, this is a tool which is very much needed in professional life as well as in your, you know, academic life. It is really a very helpful tool to know and a very easy one to actually equip yourself. So moving ahead, like since I was also a placement coordinator in TISS, I kind of had a very, I would say I did develop a little bit of an understanding that what could be the potential roads from this point. But then this is a very limited list. I believe that everybody of us, you know, can explore other opportunities. There is a whole lot actually awaiting for us. And it's always fine to even make unconventional choices and, you know, go ahead along that road. So, you know, government sector is one place where somebody can actually find themselves having completed a course on water policy and governance. But here the government sector does not typically mean the departmental jobs, but it means a lot like even working with partners who work along with the government. Like, for example, organizations like the Tata Trust or even the big fours like the KPMG, PwCs, they tend to undertake a lot of projects in collaboration with the government of India. And, you know, water is a very crucial part of many of the business ideas that they are taking under the umbrella of sustainability. So there, a person having this course, having a background in this course, has really a lot to actually do. Again, there are project openings that even come up in the Ministry of Jal Shakti, even in the Central Groundwater Board. So these are opportunities that are, you know, that we can call to be like tangents to the government sector jobs. So these are opportunities where someone can look him or herself in. Then there is the NGOs. So a person who is, you know, more drive towards working with the grassroots and maybe wants to work, you know, right at the field. So this could be an opportunity for them as well, because there are a whole lot of NGOs that are extensively working on WASH as well as on rural water governance, on irrigation water regulations. So there are, you know, organizations, NGOs also, which significantly work on these. Like, for example, the BAIF organization, BAIF, it's based in Rajasthan, and it also is doing a great good amount of job in this. Even DASRA, they also are like, these are like prominent NGOs. They have been working in this sector from a very long time and have undertaken different projects in collaboration with governments and different levels of stakeholders. And another thing is, if you're coming from this particular course, what sets you apart is conventionally many people in this sector tend to come from a civil engineering background, and as a result of which they are never been able to fill in the vacuum that lies in a holistic planning of a certain project to be put on ground, or even in the implementation of the project. So a person who is coming from a course which has given you an understanding, maybe not in depth, but a macro level understanding of what could be the technical aspects you need to take care of. Like urban water is a course that is actually going to explain you the whole lot of dynamics that, you know, revolves around us simply getting water in our taps. So this is all about, you know, urban water sector. But there is an undertone of the social dynamic that also plays. So if a person having this course can actually fill in that vacuum, which is still existing in many of these sectors and also in the interfaces of sectors. Then talking about policy think tanks, like for example, CEEW, then the Center for Policy and Research, CPR, then CSE, they have been actually doing extremely amazing work both in climate change as well as in water. And these actually serve as advisors to the state and the central level government bodies in kind of planning projects, in pitching proposals, as well as, you know, in implementing certain programs. Like, for example, I was interning with an organization called, it's an institution, research institution called ICRISAT, and it's headquartered in Hyderabad. So though it is an organization under the United Nations, but it was actually working in close proximity with the state and the central government while implementing the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So they were doing it more through wastewater management, using the technologies of constructed wetlands. And this work was more in the rural parts of Hyderabad because they wanted to operate the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan in the semi-arid pockets of India. And Hyderabad is one of the most prominent area to be, you know, having that kind of weather zone, you know, the semi-arid kind of a kind of a weather zone. And talking about research organizations, here I intend to indicate organizations which are, you know, which do a lot on research, not essentially the institutions. So research organizations like the World Resource Institute, WRI, they are stationed in Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, and they have their headquarters in the US, Washington, DC. So these organizations, they have been actually doing extensive work in water and also in the interface of water with energy, with climate. So these are like really promising avenues that one can actually look at if you know, choose to take up this particular path, or even if you choose to do anything tangential to this particular course, then there is always academia, there is the opportunity of PhD, then you can always appear for the UGC NET JRF examination and then be recruited to a project as a JRF. Like I'm presently working as a JRF at the IIT Roorkee. Then the big fours are there. You can be a part of the KP, you know, big fours like KPMG, PwC. They, as I previously mentioned, they do undertake a lot of projects under their sustainability vertical. And very recently, the fact that, you know, companies from all across the world have become so conscious about, you know, this green economy has also become a very booming discourse in the business line, that people have grown, I would say, you know, conscious to make their business greener. And that is where, you know, these companies have actually opened up a lot of opportunities for candidates coming from courses as that of water policy or even climate studies, or maybe, you know, sustainability studies. Now, speaking about ESG, ESG is the environmental, social, and governance. So these three aspects might sound disjoint to us, but they're extremely intertwined to one another. So ESG has been something, you know, there in the market from a long time in India and more significantly in abroad. But of late, since I mentioned that, you know, companies, you know, the big international organizations have also actually become more conscious, because, you know, to kind of attract investors, to kind of attract sponsorships and fundings for projects, it is very important that you comply to the larger norms that the global scenario is setting in. So that is where these opportunities as that of ESG have become an extremely promising area for someone to, you know, come ahead with. Then a map of that place, and you plot that data in the form of, you know, in the form of a representation, a pictorial representation, then it just speaks manifolds and it just accentuates the quality of explanation that you're trying to put across. So, you know, these skills actually equip you for the larger ball game. That's all, you know, I would really want to highlight with this. So my present situation is that I am stationed as a JRF with the Department of Water Resource Development and Management in IIT Roorkee. And presently I am working on a project that looks at the impacts of climate change on agricultural water requirements. And previously I have been a part of a project, the Indo-Swedish project on water, energy, food nexus, and the impact of climate change, you know, on these nexus dynamics. And my master's thesis had been also along these kind of a contemporary discourse. It has been on the concept of environmental flow regulation and management. So it's more about river management, actually. So that has largely been how my thesis has been. So when I actually chose IIT Roorkee, I had applied for there, just what I said, you know, that we have to actually go out and search. It is very important that we research, because school, again, I'm saying, is a very, very comfortable space and is perhaps the best space that all of you are in, because the moment you step out of that school gate, you know that you're there out for the harsher world. And there, you know, nobody is going to come and tell you pay attention to this or have a look at this. You have to be responsible for yourself to, you know, search and, you know, constantly research about it. So this position that I found out, even the internships that I have been associated with, I had to research. So I have been, you know, looking at it. I remember since my final year in Loreto and then more into my first year in TISS, I have actually been very closely following the kind of projects that happen in this department at IIT Roorkee. And that is where I understood, I found out which supervisor I could work with, and hence, you know, when there was an opening, went ahead and applied for that. But so, you know, like, this has been kind of a summary of my journey. But as I said right at the beginning of our presentation, that everybody's journey is very unique to him or herself. But there are just some things that I feel over these years, you know, from 2016 to today in 2021, I feel that there are just some basics. And I had done this for myself, and I would really like to share this with all of you, is starting off on some things a bit quite early. Like, for example, resume would be that document which would be, you know, a constant work in progress. Even today, the resume which I have is still a work in progress, and I know that somewhere I'm still not satisfied with how it looks, and, you know, I feel there is way more, you know, better scopes for improving that. So it's advisable that you start off as early as you can. I mean, you complete school, obviously, but it's always advisable that you maybe start off with having a resume of your own right from the first year of college. Maybe you won't have much to put in, but just having, you know, revisiting the particular document again and again, just knowing that what are the kind of sections you would want to have in your resume, because resume is going to be your final, final document that is going to explain what and how much have you done. And it is very important. I would like literally say the market term that I have heard. It will be really very important for you to sell yourself ahead across the table to the people. Like, you know, when we visit a shop, we visit any shop, we want to buy a certain TV or a mobile, we really look at the features and we try to understand that why this and why not that, right? So that's how you need to even prepare your resume, so that it can speak on behalf of you when you are not speaking for yourself. Then another thing is developing on interpersonal communication skills. I feel that this has been something that I've really tried working hard on, and you know, to reach out to people, because when you are at the end, you need something, you really have to go out, ask for that help or reach out to the person. And the more you network, the more you have the tendency of networking, you'll realize that you'll just somewhere, you know, navigate to the right person to connect with. So this is also a process that happens very gradually and over the time. And I think this takes time. Like, it must be varying for person to person, but I feel that this is something we should, you know, start working on. Then speaking about internships, we might just feel that, okay, we are just in the first year of college and maybe the second year of college, but it's very important that we start engaging ourselves in some or the other kind of internships during the breaks that we get, because it not just helps us understand better the existing course which we are a part of, but it also helps us understand where our calling is. And so I think internships, at least for me, has played a very crucial role in shaping my decisions and in shaping my choices. Then speaking about strengthening the GK, this I'm speaking from a very personal experience, because when I was out from Loreto applying for my master's, any examination you go, you will have a section on GK, no matter what you, you know, whatever you whichever exam you appear for. And GK often becomes the game changer. So it is just, you know, one day at a time, you're just trying to be aware of the world around. So I think that can be a good thing to start off with. Then speaking about the LinkedIn profile, the LinkedIn profile is a lot like, now you're in school, I understand, but the moment you complete school, LinkedIn should be kind of a social networking site where you visit as frequently you visit your WhatsApp, Facebook, and Instagram profiles, because LinkedIn is going to be a profile where you can actually see how the professional world is working. You would know, and it's also a profile that, you know, evolves over the time. It's a lot like your resume, and it also helps you enhance your visibility, make connection with people. So it is very important that, you know, you have a LinkedIn profile and you gradually build it over time. When you're in LinkedIn, you get to know that, okay, these are the kind of job opportunities that might, you know, be an option if I am taking this particular course. You can visit the profiles of XYZ people and have a look at their profiles. And you can also have an understanding that, okay, these are the skills that the people have. And if necessary, and if I have the time, then I can actually update myself with those skills. So I believe LinkedIn profile is one which, you know, you can gradually start off with, maybe after school when you enter college, but it's really a very important place to be in today's day and time. And finally is developing on writing skills. I know that I have been from this space, from this school, and I have got immense encouragement in, you know, writing our own pieces. In Mahadevi Birla, I know that how much we have, you know, been nurtured around, you know, just writing our own answers, even, you know, writing, you know, just the entire thing around writing. But then I would still say that often the way we write in school is sometimes different when we have to write outside in this professional world, or even when you are in this space of a semi-professional and academic world. So writing skills, we really need to improve where it's like, you know, it's formal. And again, it is speaking in the absence of yourself. Like, for example, on LinkedIn, if you're connecting with a certain person and if you're sending out a message on the LinkedIn profile to a person, it cannot be as casual as one you would send to somebody on a WhatsApp, right? It has to be formal, but it again cannot be the same as you would write on a mail. So different platforms have its different style of writing. And it's not always that you can verbally communicate with that person. So it is very important that we write less, but in as many words that we use, those are, you know, speaking out loud for what we are trying to say or what we are looking forward to. So these were a few points that actually came to my mind, you know, from my personal experiences. And I thought that maybe if this could help you guys. So yeah. Thank you so much. Any questions, anything if you have, I'll be really glad to share, answer, help, anything.
So I think while students think of their questions, I just wanted to say hi to Purnanjali.
Hello,
Purnanjali,
ma'am.
Mrs. Shah, such a pleasure to connect with you this evening. And I think it's such a fantastic gesture when alumni come back and they connect with other students in the present batches, because this is a connect like no other. I think it deepens the impact. And I think the wow factor comes in when the present students feel that if somebody from their school in the past has been able to scale such enormous heights of success, depth and passion and understanding of a subject that they have chosen with a great amount of love, well, they can be inspired as well. So consider yourself a torch bearer today of this career talk. And so glad that you could connect. I think your teachers feel very, very proud. The geography department, I can see, is absolutely basking. They're glowing. I think Sudeshna ma'am and Rupa ma'am are somewhere between very moved and delighted. And this is the biggest reward that you give us when you succeed. So this is our moment of inspiration and joy when we take back that something, I think, what we did in school worked well for for so many of our students. So just wanted to say thank you for coming back and giving back to your school so generously. And I do hope so many of you sitting here today will be inspired. We have students from our sister concern, a school in Siliguri, Birla Divya Jyoti, also joining us. Thanks to this online platform, we can reach across borders and boundaries, and we can really connect so that we can share generously insights, learning, attitudes, because it's all about the right mindset, the growth mindset. And I loved something that you said, because I was in Mehika's session a little while ago, and then I came back to join yours. But I think to be shaken out of your comfort zone, I think that's my takeaway today, because that's something I always tell teachers and I tell myself, that there is a time when we grow comfortable, sitting on our seats, doing things as part of our habit, as a part of course, matter of course, as a part of our routine. And there comes a time when you need to be shaken out of that so that you learn again. So to keep growing, to keep having challenges in your way, accepting them, is the only way that you will enrich yourself. And yes, of course, again, something that I believe in, enriching your CV, making the most of every opportunity that you get to enhance your CV, because I think the pandemic has taught us students that marks are a dime a dozen today. Everybody is scoring 99 and 99.6 and 99.7 and a perfect 100. And yet colleges like St. Stephen's are not happy. Even with that 99.8, the cutoffs keep rising, the aspirations keep rising. And so you have to keep pace. And the only way you can keep pace is by creating and making use of every opportunity that comes your way. So things like wherever you can engage in, where there's decision-making, engaging with policy, Teach for India, and so many other avenues. Today, we shared a platform for peer educators, for peer support group to combine together, because that is when you strategize. That is when you take decisions. That is when you collaborate and work as a team and start thinking in a manner that designs change. So leaving you with this thought, I think, Purnanjali, what you said resonated so much with me and for the entire faculty. We feel so good about having you back with us. Over to our students. I do hope you have many, many questions lined up for Purnanjali to be grilled and skewered. I'm sure she's going to be enjoying that, answering your questions. Please keep your cameras on. It's very, very rude to turn your camera off while someone is speaking. Please be patient, value the time and the commitment, and go ahead and ask your questions.
I think Mehak, she has...
We can have somebody coordinating the question answers. Hands could be raised, and simply either one of the faculty members or a student, the one who introduced Purnanjali, can just introduce or call out the name and the student can ask her question. I think I can see Pratiti Ghosh, Preetha Bhattacharya, Adrija. So in that order, if you can just ask Pratiti, Preetha, Adrija.
Yes, so the question which I had that Purnanjali, if you could give us a few guidelines, like how to apply and prepare for a course in such a prestigious institute like Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai.
Okay, so as I told you, like you first have to figure out that what is the course you would want to take, because if you visit the website of TISS Mumbai, you'll see they have a host of courses to actually offer a student. So it's very important you first identify what is that you would want to take for yourself, go ahead with. And you know, then on their website only you will find these things of how the exam pattern is designed. And something very important is why I mentioned to, you know, build up the understanding of GK, because at least for TISNET, I can say GK is a real game changer. I know that we come from a school and we really have good, you know, fluency with our English, but there would be, you know, good number of other people who are also fluent with the English. And, you know, they can able to, you know, score fine in that English section. They might be even scoring pretty good in the section that's about quantitative and logical reasoning. But GK, again, you know, just upgrades the level of competition. Since these are competitive exams, I don't want to sound competitive, but just telling a reality that that one mark, even, you know, in these kind of exams really matter. You get a seat or you don't get a seat. So it's very important that you, you know, start grooming yourself whenever you set the target, maybe a year before that. You just need to, you know, manage along with your present academic pursuits and just take out time and be motivated to prepare yourself for the examination and the process.
Thank you.
No worries.
Should I go ahead with my question?
Yes, please.
Actually, I wanted to ask you, what was the greatest challenge you faced when you started working for your research program and how did you overcome it?
The greatest challenge is I started my thesis when we were in the middle of pandemic. So it was everything new. Like even my supervisor didn't have anything to guide me along the point that how should I be actually taking care of my primary data collection. So primary data collection is practically being on field and having a detailed interview with your tools. So these have been actually major challenge points for me. But then I think the way I chose to navigate through this challenge is I started developing my research skills and also my thesis in a way that it's not extensively just, you know, aligned towards one particular type. Like it's not completely dependent on the field. It also has a section to do good section to do with data. So it was a thing that even if I'm not able to make it to the field, the analysis and the outcomes I will be having from the data would be there to sail my thesis through it. But then I was able to manage both just because, you know, the COVID, the pandemic was having a flattening peak around that time in the December 2020. But then I kind of chose to navigate through it in that way. So that's kind of largely my approach.
Thank you.
Adrija? Yes.
Yes, ma'am. I wanted to ask that if you could please share an experience where you supervise reduction of waste management. Water waste, actually.
Okay. So I technically did not supervise, but I was a part of the project. So that was the internship that I was mentioning I've done with ICRISAT. So it was more about wastewater management and how we treat that wastewater for reuse in the villages. So I was a part of that project and it was a technology known as the constructed wetlands that was being used. So it's a completely technical setup, which I don't know, I'll just try to explain it. I don't know if you would get it, but I'll try. So it's just designed like, you know, these these constructs have compartments and it just works under the simple concept of gravity. And there are different gravel sizes. So it's very much science. So there's just like the way we kind of tend to operate the, you know, traditional filters, we have different types of sizes of gravels placed. And then we did have a special type of, these grasses. So these grasses actually helped us in biofiltering the wastewater as well. So we had two rounds of that kind of a filtering. And then finally, the water which was coming out as a produce, we would again filter it through another round of an floating wetland. So the floating wetland was again a form of artificial wetland. This entire infrastructure is based using the concept of what wetland largely does. So in that way, the water is being treated, but it did have its challenges. The biggest shortcoming is a constructed wetland with this kind of a concept and functionality cannot be applied in an urban area, because the urban wastewaters are very high on other toxics like that of lead and high percents of sulfur. And these infrastructures are not capable enough to filter out that level of toxins. So yeah, if that answers your question, Adrija, I don't really know.
Thank you.
Okay, we have Anvika Bajaj from Birla Divya Jyoti. She has a question to ask. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Anvika.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, among all the sectors of geography that you introduced to us, what made you choose water policy? And continue it.
So I, as I mentioned during the presentation, first was obviously the discourse of water in itself. It is an extremely emerging, you know, place of conversation in whichever sector you take up. You want to understand food, you want to understand climate change. Water just has a very crucial role to play everywhere. Then the hydrology course that was there as a part of my undergrad in geography, that even kind of, you know, just made me curious to know more about that course. And last but not the least, also the curriculum that TISS was offering us, the kind of professors, the faculty which we had Dr. Himanshu Kulkarni to teach us groundwater, and he's considered the pioneer of groundwater in India. Like, he is a part of the committee which has framed the national water policy and is still doing that. So to be having such faculty teach us closely and personally what groundwater is, how groundwater is functioning, to have Sujit Kunan, who is again a very big name in legal, you know, in the legal sector of water. He is like very closely worked with the very famous conflict that had come up with the Coca-Cola factory in a village in Kerala. It's like one of the most famous cases where community and corporate giants' water needs, you know, just combine. So when we have Sujit Sarkar speaking and telling us how law functions in water, so having these kind of faculty from IIT Bombay, so, you know, these have been the major points, you know, motivations to fight through and get through in TISS for this course. So yeah,
thank you, ma'am.
Shohini, if you could go ahead with your question. Shohini.
Yes, ma'am. Purnanjali, I wanted to know that what keeps you motivated so that, you know, you can sustain your interest in your specific area of work.
So I have always, like, I've realized that really my calling has been research, and the only thing that I feel motivates me in research is reading. I don't know, you might be feeling it to be pretty boring or maybe pretty conventional, but that is how it works, like, right? When we're working on a certain project, we search for the literature to support our statements and hypothesis for that project. And while we are doing that, when we're reading more, we just get to understand that, okay, these are some other gaps that can actually also be explored. So that actually keeps me motivated. And obviously, like, my passion for research is the other one.
Thank you.
Yes, Adrija, you also have a question to ask, Adrija.
Ma'am, I asked.
Okay.
Mehak can ask. Ma'am, Mehak has raised her.
Mehak.
So, is there any Ganges protection law? And if it's, then how does it work?
I beg your pardon. What protection law?
Am I audible now?
Yeah. Better.
Yeah. So, is there any Ganges protection law?
Ganges.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Ganges.
No worries. As far as I remember, there are schemes. There are no particular laws per se. There are a lot of schemes that are actually operating. There are schemes which the Ministry of Jal Shakti is doing in collaboration with the Ministry of Youth. So they're just trying to pull in, you know, these youth people from all these, they call it the Ganga Duts. So yes, this is a new name I recently came across. They're calling these young people, the young volunteers, as the Ganga Duts, and they're trying to take them up from all these states which line the entire course of Ganges, right from starting from Uttarakhand to West Bengal. So the government has come up with these kind of schemes and the projects, and the approach is to actually make it more community driven, because I believe somewhere now it's well understood that diplomacy and desk policies cannot save the river anymore. I think we all have very recently read about how Yamuna is in a present state. I think in the newspapers everywhere it was, you know, it was all across. And
And it's a very known thing that this is happening to Yamuna, the leather factories that line up, you know, the course of Yamuna. Apart from that, there's so much of pollutants that is, you know, being contributed. Even, you know, these pollution is, you know, this is the different types of pollution. You're seeing Yamuna in a way we see Delhi today choked in as a gas chamber. So these are just consequences of human activities. So, you know, I feel that coming back to your question, there are not any laws, but there are multiple schemes. So, you know, it's not about controlling something, but the idea is about regulating something. So when we are trying to regulate something, what I understood from my master's course, you cannot actually have, you know, a law. You need to just regulate, like, let people also take a decision of their own. After all, we're democracy. So, yeah.
Yes, Koninika?
Yes, ma'am. Could you please share a few ideas on how we can implement rainwater harvesting in a metropolitan city like Kolkata?
I think the urban water body under the West Bengal government has already done a couple of projects, and they are in pursuits of some. And I think towards Salt Lake, I was just reading somewhere they have an objective to, you know, do something of that sort, where you can obviously do a rooftop harvesting. You can also have these pipelines associated to your house where you can actually do an artificial recharging of the groundwater. So from rainwater, as I was just reading very briefly, there are some plans, you know, some, I don't exactly remember, you know, the source, I cannot cite, but I was actually reading about these potential projects and very recently had even an opportunity to interact with one of the senior official there from the urban water, you know, the water department under our state ministry. So this is a vision that they're actually, you know, looking forward to, where they're able to do a rooftop harvesting, and then they're also able to do an artificial ground water recharge. So yeah, this is what I kind of know for now. I don't know if that helped you with your question.
Thank you so much.
Yes, Aditi from, I think, Aditi also wants to ask a question. Aditi Bothra, okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. So my question is that after changing your stream, did you find any problem or your study pattern had to be changed because from science to like geography, how was the leap you took or the change came into your life?
To be very honest, Aditi, I really never felt any difference. Somewhere I feel that since I had science, and I know like every course has good amount of pressure in class 11 and 12, because under CBSE board, what we learn in 10 to 11, it's a great leap, no matter which course you're taking. But recently in CU, the pattern has changed. But when I was studying under CU, it was a yearly pattern. So I kind of had to remember whatever I learned for an entire year and then write a final exam at the end of the year. So I feel the kind of pressure that I was exposed to while pursuing science, that really helped me manage very well my schedules. And speaking about shift in subject, I really never felt that kind of a shift or change, because I liked geography when I was in class 10 as well. So it really was not, you know, kind of any rough transition. It was really a conscious choice and a transition. So yeah.
Thank you.
Swayam, I think that's Swayam from Billa Divya Jyoti.
Good afternoon, everyone. Ma'am, if you could please answer my question, that how did you face the people, the obstacles and the challenges that came in your journey?
The challenges that came in my journey, is that you're asking?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I think challenges is a part and parcel for anything you do. It's just there. I mean, sometimes if you don't have challenges, you would just not know what success is or what it is to achieve that. And I'm telling this to you,
from my experience, like when I still remember when I was appearing for my TIS examination, I told you, right? So after the TIS, so I targeted TIS along with my bachelor's. So there was no gap. So everything I was doing simultaneously, I was also preparing for my CU examinations and I was also preparing for TISNET. So the day I had my personal interview, the next day I had my first paper to write under practical geography, which was a 7 hours paper. So under CU. So I remember I went to Mumbai on 4th of March, I still remember. On 5th of March, I had my interview. I gave my interview that night. I had to take a flight. Overnight in the airport, I was studying. In midnight, I reached Kolkata. That night, I did not sleep. I studied because I have to. I revised everything. Next day, I went to the revision center. The examination center, wrote my exam for 6 hours and came back home. And I remember then I slept. So this was a massive challenge because nothing could actually be changed. I could not even request the CU to shift my examination date because it's with the entire batch. But the day I got the results in TISS, and I saw that I have got through all these challenges, tasted really sweet. So I think it's just the motivation to navigate through them has helped me face these challenges as well.
Yes, Koninika wanted to ask a question. Koninika, are you there in the meeting?
Yes, ma'am. I'm already asking my question.
Koninika, you're over with your question. Okay.
Yes.
Then Zunera, is Zunera there? Zunera also, I think she wanted to ask a question.
Zunera?
Zunera?
She's not here.
Zunera, I think I can see her. Zunera? Okay. So anybody else who would like to ask a question? Yes, Mehak has raised her hand.
Mama,
yes,
I have another question.
Yes, sure.
What are your future plans as far as your career is concerned?
So I really have a strong calling for research and presently I'm working as a JRF. So to, pursue to have a profession in and around research is what I really look forward to. So, yeah.
Thank you.
No worries.
Yes, anybody else who would like to ask a question? Anyone? Ma'am?
Yes.
From Bilda Divya Jyoti, anybody, any other student would like to ask a question, ma'am? Priyanka, ma'am, any other student would like to ask a question?
Children, no. Anyone else?
No. I guess. No, ma'am, thank you.
All of you keep your videos on.
Yes.
Aditi, Kaninika, ma'am just now told, keep your videos on, please.
It's been such an enriching experience for us also, Punanjali. Yeah, I was learning with you so much, so much to learn and so much
That's
to
what Ms. Ghosh also expressed, that we are also learning from her. It's such an honored moment for us to see.
Yes, thank you. Kind of poise, the kind of confidence, not only your success, but the personality traits that you are, there's so much to learn from you, not only us, but as students of our school, students of Bilda Divya Jyoti. I think there's so much to learn from you, how you have handled obstacles in life, and you have never given up. So that is something, that's really encouraging and inspiring for all of us here in this session. Thank you, Punanjali, for being what you are. And you really held, the name of our school, really, it has also escalated along with your success. We also have a like a bit of, we also share a bit, isn't it? We, your teachers, we also can share, you know, have a little bit of share in your success too. So thank you. Thank you for being with us. So Neelakshi, over to you now. Neelakshi.
Good evening to one and all present here. We express our heartfelt thanks to Ms. Purnanjali Chandra, our esteemed past pupil and guest for today's back to school session. Your story has been a great inspiration to all of us. It has opened our minds to the wide range of opportunities in your respective domain. This interaction will also help us in our future while choosing our career. I would also like to thank our respected teachers and audience, without whom this program would not have been such a great success. Last but not the least, I would like to thank our principal and our school management for organizing such a valuable program of job shadowing for us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Neelakshi. Thank you, ma'am. I also
Admirable time with us. It was such an insightful, informative session. I think all of us have get benefit out of it. The road, what you have showed. Thank you. Thank you, Chad. So stay blessed.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Stay blessed. I just want to keep
shining. To Purnanjali. Purnanjali, yes, when you're studying that, I would like, if you have not yet come across about the wetlands of east, in the east of Kolkata, since you're from West Bengal, I would like you to talk about it in Mumbai also, because it is the only wetland in the world which treats sewage naturally. The largest and the only wetland, and it's not known in India, sadly. So since you're into water management, I think I would put it on your shoulders to spread the message of that, because if you just study it, you will find that it's the only wetland which treats its natural, you know, how the delta was built, and geography students are here, and how it got transferred and the sewage is thrown over there. There is no sewage treatment plant in Kolkata because of the East Calcutta wetlands. That's a very, very important thing, which it's known all over the world, but sadly less in India. So if you can take up that work once, when you talk about it, do talk about that so that it spreads the message. People will say I'm biased, but well, that's what I am. All right, thank you.
We stay in the city, ma'am. We stay in the city.
Yes,
so it's our, as a citizen, it's our responsibility also. So yes, if and you are the torch barriers of ours, so you can just do the needful, as ma'am has.
Yes, all right. Sure, thank you, Purnanjali. Thank you.